Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Jim Cora, where is he? Ah, congratulations. And Odense University. It's a brilliant story, and I hope to hear more about it. I can speak very soft, I hear. This is me, the new biology of aging. I'm a medic, and I think I'm asked and obliged, I think, to bring, let's say, the aspect of medicine into, let's say, the mathematics, birth and death. And as a starter, I want to say that, let's say, for me as a clinician, death is not a single event. Death is a complex beast. It has different underlying pathologies. And the key point for today is that the pathology may change over the lifespan. Death in early age is something completely different than death in old age. And maybe it can even contribute to, let's say, the skewness of, let's say, the population distribution data in old age compared to young age. But of course, as Jim has explained, it's all about birth, death, and mathematics. We first have to go for birth. And this is my picture of birth. Because birth is also a complex thing. It is the result of a strict evolutionary program, and that is designed to for development, sex, and taking care of our children. And it's, and that's, I think, let's say, the key thing. It ends up uniformly. Sorry, but let's say at age puberty, we are pretty similar, I would say. When aging comes about, then there is difference. Because there is a stochastic accumulation of permanent damage. And that is the net outcome of you being damaged every moment of the day in red, and your body trying to resolve, let's say, the problem. But as, let's say, the repair is almost always not sufficient to overcome, let's say, the damage completely, you are accumulating damage over your lifetime. And what you see every morning in the mirror, it's getting worse. From a medical doctor that's inside your body with the same rate. Yeah? It's almost, let's say, the resemblance, how you look at the outside also is roughly the same as you look in at the inside. And therefore, it doesn't come to a surprise that age is the most important risk factor of disease. And that is most of the time that is not addressed appropriately. Because we think, for instance, that cancer is due to smoking or cardiovascular disease is because of high cholesterol. But let's say if this is at the age of 45, the risk is one, you see that age is the main driver because of the accumulation of damage, stochastically, the main driver of the risk of cardiovascular death in old age. And here I want to bring in, let's say, an epidemiological concept, and Cora is quite familiar with that, and that is the basic thinking about causes of diseases and death from Rothman. And I pause here for maybe a minute. What you see here is the what Rothman calls, let's say, the sufficient cause of death. Think about somebody who at a certain age, 45, with high cholesterol, smoking, him being a male, and exposed to stress, died from a cardiovascular event. The other death from of cardiovascular causes is something completely different. Yes, there is aging and cholesterol, but the F and the G and the H are different than the C, the D, and the E. These are different component causes because this was a male, female, who suffered from hypertension. And she, being a female, also exposed to estrogens, was a sufficient cause for her to suffer from a fatal cardiovascular event at the age of 60. So when you are thinking about death and also death from cardiovascular causes, there might be different underlying pathologies beneath it. Death is a complex beast. It is also, let's say, when you take, let's say, the various people at the age of 55 who died from a cardiovascular event, But now, and this is, let's say, the key message for my talk, I think that there are enough data to consider that, let's say, most of, let's say, the people who die at young age, relatively young old age and very old age, have different component causes that contribute to, let's say, their disease and their death, and that has major complications. I will show you two examples of that. I stay within the domain of cardiovascular death because that comes close to you and it's easy to understand. It's about cholesterol and hypertension. The data come from, let's say, the Leiden 85 plus study. Tom, thank you for introducing. You just go into town and you bump in all the 85-year-olds and you ask them whether they will be, whether they allowed to be examined, and you just follow them for function, disease, and death. And when you apply, let's say, the Framingham risk score, and everybody knows that, let's say that is that amalgamate from hypertension, cholesterol, diabetes, and if you bump in the doctor, he says, oh, you're in danger or not. If you apply that risk score to all the people, and you have a high risk, an intermediate risk, or a low risk, it doesn't have any discriminating power for identifying those with high or a low risk for cardiovascular mortality. So does it mean that it doesn't matter if you have hypertension, high cholesterol, things like that in old age? And the answer is yes. You can't be true. You're lying. No, I'm not. Let's take the example from cholesterol. You think cholesterol is a bad thing. Here you see the cardiovascular mortality accumulating over, let's say, the follow-up. And here you see the it's highest in, let's say, the red line. So if there is a difference, cardiovascular mortality is highest among those with the lowest LDL cholesterol. Statistically, there is no difference. So don't worry in old age if you have a high LDL cholesterol. Biology of cardiovascular disease in old age is different. Some people may think, and maybe Jim pops up, this is the intrinsic population frailty, and those who are susceptible already died. And you end up with, let's say, those who are resistant against the LDL. Personally, I think that is not a complete explanation, because if you go for HDL cholesterol, and you know that HDL, when you have a high level of HDL, that's a good thing, that is still discriminating. And those with the lowest HDL still have, let's say, a twofold increased risk of cardiovascular disease. So I don't dispute with Jim that selection is at play, but it can't explain fully for, let's say, the data that we have observed. If you end up here, as a doctor, you don't know what to do. So then finally you end up with an experiment, and that's what we did. We just treated people with cholesterol lowering. And this is, let's say, the design of, let's say, PROSPER study that we started in the late 90s. You just take, let's say, 6,000 men and women of old age, 75, that has never done before, and you treat them with cholesterol lowering, and you look for the outcome. This is the main result. If you take all the outcomes we were thinking about, hospitalization, getting a stent, let's say that is repairing your coronary arteries, but also death, etc., you see a rather modest effect. However, if you go for the endpoint we were interested in, whether cholesterol lowering was able to decrease the number of deaths from cardiovascular disease, there is no effect. Even after, let's say, when we follow the people for longer after, let's say, finishing the trial. So doesn't, let's say, you may argue that, let's say, the drug may not be strong enough to imply an effect. The same drug was also used in 55-year-olds, us. And here you see the results. Here the drug works wonderful. You see a 20 to 30% decrease in the risk of cardiovascular mortality, but not in old age. Old age is different. Hypertension. We followed the 85-year-olds for cumulative mortality depending on strata of hypertension. And you see that hypertension is very discriminative. It matters depending on which blood pressure you have. But see that the cumulative mortality is highest in those with the lowest blood pressure. Cumulative mortality is lowest at those with hypertension. And this holds for the systolic blood pressure, and it also holds for the diastolic blood pressure. Why that? For the cholesterol story, I couldn't give you any proper explanation. But for the hypertension, and therefore I use this example, I do have an intuitive explanation. Think about blood pressure. Because with drugs you can, let's say, decrease blood pressure. Here, this is the normal blood pressure, 140 over 90. You can decrease it and you can increase it. Okay. You know, let's say, the red story. Hypertension is bad for you because it damages your organs. But let me ask you another question. Why do you have on Earth blood pressure? It's because you need the perfusion pressure to function for the heart, the brain, the muscle. Okay. So there is also a good thing. If you are in your car and your blood pressure goes down, there is a light that is bing, 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 and a noise. You have to stop. And that's with blood pressure also. When blood pressure is too low, there is no life. Okay, so there is a bad side and there is a good side. So probably, let's say, the bad side and the good side in old age is different compared to younger age. And that's what you see here. Like we did with cholesterol, other colleagues, they have decreased blood pressure in old age because they thought, high blood pressure is bad for you. And when you accumulate all, let's say, the data, there are about 4,000 people included in randomized controlled trials over the age of 80, and the net effect of, let's say, blood pressure treatment is unity. That makes, or the interpretation, it doesn't make any sense. Your risk remains the same. And again, if you go to younger age, when you include people from 60 years and older, you see the benefit. So blood pressure in young age is a bad thing, but not in old age. Conclusions for the moment. Aging is a random accumulation of damage. And that coincides very nicely with this idea of Rotman, that you have different combinations of component causes that are sufficient for death. Every death is different. The key thing I want to show here is generalized that, let's say, these sufficient causes in middle age are different from, let's say, the average sufficient causes in old age. We do have to recognize that you can't extrapolate knowledge about disease and death from middle age, which is abundant, to old age. You start getting problems. Medically, I show you, and in a moment, also statistically, mathematically. Understanding of disease in older people is just at its infancy. And like Meta was talking about the evolutionary shadow, I am always explaining to people like you or medics that aging is occurring in a knowledge shadow. Why presenting, let's say, medicine like this here in this audience? Here you see the trends in life expectancy at the age 65, from 65 onwards, and also over calendar time. So this is residual life expectancy when you bump into your 65th anniversary. It's about 15 years in 1950, and is rapidly on the decrease. And it's rapidly on the decrease. This is for women, but the same trends hold for men. Rapidly on the increase in Japan. But here, let's see what we call the Dutch disease, because we are championing, let's say from 1950 here, really we are front runners, but then we have lost track. And until this moment, we don't know why. I give you three types of explanations. The first two are well known, and the third one you have learned now. That's the end of the story also. Of course, we think about cohort effects. Japanese women born in, let's say, in the 1920s are different from, let's say, those who were born in the Netherlands. Might be. Difference in the early environmental exposures. The other one is population heterogeneity. People live in a different environment, and let's say the different environment has different impacts on the various causes of death, smoking behavior, etc. And now, and that's my conclusion here, there is a third one. Diseases are different in old age, and they are treated differently in various countries. Some countries treat hypertension, others do not. In the Netherlands, we think that when you bump into hypertension, you should be treated. Wait a moment. If you bump into a German doctor's office and you feel worried, fatigue, I don't feel well, and you have a low blood pressure, you're prescribed amphetamines. Thank you very much. Yeah.